I'm coming from Hungary. I'm Syslog-ng evangelist, and do Syslog-ng packaging support and advocacy. So let me give you a quick overview. First, in a few words, I will talk about what you need for this workshop. Then I will give you an introduction to Syslog-ng and its four major roles. Then I will talk a bit about logging basics. Then we will change to a bit more practical side and learn about configuring and testing Syslog-ng. We will go on to networking topics, and then for the part which is more interesting from the security point of view, filters and parsers within Syslog-ng. And finally, if we have time, we will also see how to send logs to Elasticsearch. So, what you need, if you want to follow my workshop, is a laptop, and I have a bunch of USB keys with virtual machine image, and also with my slides. I will hand it out, and please copy it on your machine, and hand it on, and at the end, please give them back to me. Sure. I tested if this image works fine with VirtualBox and VMware as well. I use VMware, but it's up to you what you have. There are two users on it. Of course, it has root, and it also has a user called workshop, and both have the password workshop. One note before diving into Syslog-ng is that this workshop was originally 3 hours long. Now we have 1.5 hours. I cut out many slides and tried to speak as fast as possible. Still I have some doubts if we can finish everything on time. What is logging? It's a recording of events. My favorite example is SSHD. You see a log message here, just like you could find in your word log messages. What is Syslog-ng? It's a syslog implementation enhanced logging daemon with a strong focus on portability and high-performance central log collection. It was originally developed in C, but it can be extended in Python or Java as well. So, why central logging is so important that I mentioned in the Syslog-ng definition? First of all, it's ease of use. You have one place to check instead of many when you want to check your log messages. It's also availability. Even if the sending machine is unreachable for some reason, you can check your log messages and even use it to figure out why the sender machine is down. And last but not least, it's also security. As the first thing when a machine is compromised is removing the traces of the compromise. But if you have central logging and your log messages are pushed in real time to another location, then even if the logs are removed later on, you have a central location where you can check what happened to your compromised machine. Syslog-ng has four major roles. It can collect log messages, it can process messages, it can filter messages, and finally store them somewhere, either locally or forward somewhere. Let's talk about data collection. Syslog-ng can collect system and application logs together, which can provide quite useful contextual data for either side. There are a wide variety of platform-specific sources like Devlog, Journal, Sunstreams, and so on. As a central local actor, obviously it speaks all of the different Syslog protocols, the legacy one, the new one, and understands its over UDP, TCP, and encrypted connections. And there are many other log sources, pipes, sockets, pipes, even application output can be used as a log source. And there is also a new Jolly Joker available for probably only for a year or less than a year. It's the Python source. So you can extend Syslog-ng in Python and create an HTTP server receiving log messages like the HTTP event collector in Splunk, or you can fetch messages from Amazon CloudWatch or Kafka or whatever you want. Anything what is supported by Python. The next one is processing. You can classify, normalize, and structure log messages with many different built-in parsers. You can divide messages, and you don't have to think about falsifying, but for example, if you are required to anonymize your log messages by compliance, then you can use rewriting for anonymization. You can also reformat log messages using templates. So if your destination needs a specific format, like it needs ISO date or JSON formatting like Elasticsearch, then you can do that. And you can also enrich your log data, for example, using GYIP or create an additional fields based on the message content. And here again, Python is a Jolly Joker, as it can do any of the above. And you can also use Python to enrich log messages from a database, or even do filtering from Python, which brings us to our next topic, filtering. It has two main uses. The better known is discarding surplus log messages, like except for some special cases, you don't want to store debug level messages, as that can fill up your storage quite quickly. And it's also message routing, meaning, for example, that making sure that all anything related to authentication reaches your SIEM system. There are many possibilities for filtering. It can be based on message content, different message parameters, or macros. You can do comparisons, use regular expressions, many different filtering functions. And best of all, you can combine any of these using Boolean operators. Thank you. Finally, you have to store your log messages somewhere. Traditional log messages were stored locally in flat files or sent over the network using one of the Syslog protocols and stored at the central location into flat files. Over the years, many different destinations were added to Syslog-ng. First, different SQL databases, message queuing systems like AMQP, Stomp, Kafka, and different big data destinations like Hadoop, Elasticsearch, MongoDB. So, here again we have some Jolly Jokers like Python and Java. Actually, some of the big data destinations are implemented in Java. Let's talk a few words about log messages. If you take a look at var log messages, most of the logs have a pretty free form but still structured format. It starts with a date, a hostname, and some text at the end. this is yet another SSH login message, and you can see that the text part is practically a complete English sentence with some variable parts in it, which is pretty easy to read by a human. It was originally intended to be read by humans. On the other hand, if you want, if you have many servers, lots of users, I wonder when you will read log messages at 1,000 messages per second. So you rather try to create alerts and report from your log messages, but that's quite difficult from these pre-formatted log messages, as all applications have different logs. There is a solution for this problem. It's called structured logging. In this case, instead of writing freeform text, events are represented as name-value pairs. For example, my favorite SSH login event can be described with an application name, a username, a source IP. The good news is that Syslog-ng has name-value pairs inside right from the beginning, so it's quite well prepared for this test. A date, facility, priority, everything else was represented as name value pairs within Syslog-ng that to make templates possible. So we will talk about those later. And parsers within Syslog-ng can turn unstructured and some of the structured data like CSV or JSON into name value pairs as well. Why is it important? Because in this case you can easily create a filter or alert or whatever based on the content of the name value pair. So not just a whole message, an unstructured text, but a field part out from this text. For example, alert if there is a SSH login by root. So, before going on to more serious topics, a tricky question for you. Which is the most used Syslog-ng version? Project started 21 years ago. Red Hat Apple, which is our most popular distro, has version 3.5, and the latest stable version, well, I forgot to update it, it's 3.24. What do you think? Which is the most popular version? Well, not most popular, most used version. Well, it's you were getting quite close to it. It's 1.6. As there are well over 100 million Kindle ebook readers, and each and every of them are running Syslog-ng for logging. I don't think there are any servers, virtual machines, whatever, in this number, anywhere. So, back to something more serious, it's configuring and testing Syslog-ng. And here comes my initial advice, don't panic. It's simple and logical, even if it doesn't look so at the first sight, or even the second one. Syslog-ng configuration has a pipeline model, which means that there are many different building blocks, sources, destinations, filters, parsers, rewrites, and so on. And these building blocks are connected together using log statements into pipelines. Let's see how a source looks like. The generic definition is at the top of the screen, so it starts with a source statement, then an identifier, and then comes a list of source drivers. At the bottom of the screen you can see a very simple example, a file source, so it's reading a file, and here is a more complicated one. A single source in your configuration as well, but it has four different log sources listed. Internal stands for the internal messages of Syslog-ng. There are two file sources here and a Unix stream source for devlog. There are also flags, what can influence how your source works. Here I list only the most important ones, like no parse, disable. By default, all of the incoming messages are parsed as syslog by Syslog-ng. But for example, if you receive a pure JSON message, then it doesn't really work. So you can disable parsing with the no parse flag. And there are many more filters in the listed in the documentation. Source drivers, I already mentioned internal, Unix stream, Unix diagram, so the traditional devlog or and many other socket sources, the systemd journal, so Syslog-ng can read log messages from the journal and read all of the different name value pairs from the journal. It can read files, pipes, obviously network sources, either for the legacy or the new Syslog protocol. And there is a common mistake when it comes to sources in Syslog-ng that which is duplicating sources in the Syslog-ng configuration. As for example, entering the network source twice, as you want to use it in two different scenarios, don't duplicate sources in your configuration. You can, once you define the source, you can reuse it in your configuration as many times as you want. On the other hand, you cannot bind to the same source IP and port twice. There is a special source in Syslog-ng. It's called the system source, which is important because it makes your life easier. Right, there are many systems without systemd anymore, but when there was a long transition period, and if you used the system source, then you could use the same configuration no matter what were your log sources, as the system source automatically detects the platform-specific log sources. So it can detect if you use devlog or journal, and you can even use the same configuration cross-platform as if you use the same configuration as Sun on a Sun system, then it will use Sun streams. So it hides some platform-specific configuration from you, making your life easier. Next, the other mandatory part of the configuration is destination, as you need to store your log messages somewhere. Yet again, the general declaration is that destination keyword, then an identifier for the destination, and then you can list as many destination drivers as you want. It is a very simple file destination at the bottom of the screen, writing log messages to varlog syslog. Obviously, there are a lot more different destination drivers, mentioned files, pipes, sockets, network using either the legacy or the new syslog protocol. You can even print log messages to a terminal, but that's not really recommended as it's a blocking and terminals are slow. So if you have tons of log messages, it can slow down your logging. Program destination makes it easy to write your own specialized destination, as Syslog-ng can scan an application and write to its standard input, and I mentioned SQL, Hadoop, and I already mentioned all the different big data destinations and so on. There are many other elements what can be used in a Syslog-ng configuration, like options, which can modify how Syslog-ng works. Many of these can be set globally, and when you need to override, you can at the specific destinations also you can override it there. Macros are the results of message parsing. So if you parse your syslog message, you can then the parse values are stored in macros like date, process ID, or if you write your own message parsing, then also we will see many examples later on. And templates, using templates, you can define your own message formatting or even file name. You can also use it for file naming. There are also filters we will talk about, parsers, and rewrites as well. Finally, the heart of the configuration is the log path, which connects all of these elements together for message routing. At the top of the screen, you can see a very simple log path using just a single source and a destination, which is perfectly valid. But you can complicate it as much as you like it, listing many different sources, filters, destinations, parsers, whatever you want. Here is a very simple Syslog-ng configuration. It starts always with a version number, like 3.19. You can include external configurations from syslog-ng.com, and one is included by default. It's called scl.com. It stands for Syslog-ng Configuration Library, and we will learn about it on the next slide. Obviously, you can comment your configuration file, and here the options stands for the global options I mentioned on the previous slide. For example, you can set, you can make sure that all of your log messages are written to disk as soon as they arrive, but on a mail server where you have hundreds of messages arriving each second, you don't want to slow down your system to write all of the messages immediately. So you set a go by option that you write everything immediately, but override it at the destination later on, that for the destination you want to write messages only when 100 messages are collected together. Next, you can see some typical building blocks of the Syslog-ng configuration. A source with a system source and internal source drivers, a destination, file var log messages, and a filter, which is typical for var log messages. And at the bottom of the screen, you can see the log statement, which connects all of these different building blocks into a pipeline. As you see in the log statement, a source, and here we refer to the name of the source, yet again, a filter, default, oops, oh, here it is, and destination. So we, in the, from the log statement, we refer to the name of the different building blocks. I mentioned already the Syslog-ng configuration library. It's a collection of configuration snippets. They are accessible from your configuration just like any other Syslog-ng driver. Don't really see any difference. Some of these were turned into application adapters, which means from the Syslog-ng terminology, it means automatic message parsing. We will use this in one of the sample configurations. There is a nice regular expression for credit card number matching, a regular expression spanning probably 5 lines. But if you are in an environment which is regulated by PCI DSS, this can come quite handy. The Elasticsearch HTTP destination is also a configuration snippet in the Syslog-ng configuration library, as there is a generic HTTP destination within Syslog-ng. And this is actually a configuration block which wraps around this generic HTTP destination driver. And there are many more possibilities here, configurations for different logging as a service providers like Logly and so on. So, question, anybody, does everyone have the virtual machine image copied? Then you should also import it to your software. As soon we will try to use it as well. By default, once you installed Syslog-ng, it starts in the background. So the first step we will do will be stopping Syslog-ng, as during the workshop we will start it from the command line and start it in the foreground. So it's the virtual machine has CentOS 7. Which means that it's using systemd and systemctl. You can use that, or you can also use the Syslog-ng has a utility called Syslog-ng-ctl. You can use that to stop Syslog-ng as well. It has many other features like querying statistics from Syslog-ng or changing debug levels and so on. Syslog-ng has many options. The few options we will use are listed here. You can use the minus s for syntax checking. The minus capital F it stands for foreground starting. With debug and variables, you have many more output on screen, and minus small f is used to choose an alternate configuration. We will use these during the workshop, as we use the regular Syslog-ng configuration untouched, and instead of that we will have many configurations prepared. As I mentioned, we will start Syslog-ng in the foreground. This way it's easier to see any configuration problems, and also you can quickly stop it using Ctrl-C once you want to use another config. And we will use two different tools for testing. I guess everyone knows Locker. It's a simple syslog tool installed on default by default on all Linux systems, which can send a single syslog message. And Syslog-ng comes bundled with Log-ng. Originally, it was used for benchmarking Syslog-ng, so it can generate some patterns and you can change what, and it can measure what speed it's emitting messages and so on. But it can also send messages from files. And we will use that feature. So here comes our first practice session. We will test a very minimal configuration and also starting stopping Syslog-ng. Here is the configuration which we will use. It's really very simple, just a version number, a source, a destination, and the log statement which connects the two together. Any questions until now? The root password is workshop, and there is a workshop user also with workshop password. Originally, I made this workshop in a way that people could write their own configurations, and I put, but on the other hand, I put everything in a directory called etc syslog-ng cheating for those who were typing more slowly and still wanted to run the test commands. I think right now we don't have time for typing. But if you change to this directory, you will see that there are quite a lot of different configurations, and on my slides you will see not on this one, but most of the time you will see on the slides which configuration to use. For example, in this case it's minimal, and so let's make sure that Syslog-ng is not running. Can you see what's on my projector also? Okay. So let's stop Syslog-ng. So as it starts by default on your in your virtual machine, and now start it from the command line. So first of all, it's a capital F, minus capital F, so it starts in the foreground, and then a small f, and minimal .conf. And here is a problem immediately, as it writes that the configuration format is old, and check if there are any incompatibilities with 3.21, which is installed here. So just stop it with Control C and edit it. Vi minimal.conf. And replace the version number from 3.19 to 3.21. And save it. Now I started it. And as you can see, no warning messages were printed on screen. you can also add some debugging, the D and V, debug and verbose, and you will see a lot more messages on screen. As it prints out every module, what is installed on the system, as these are loaded, the version number and everything. Now let's send some test messages. And you see here it is, and you can see that it's coming through the journal that this is not a test. So I stopped it, and as you can see, it's also in word log messages. Okay, everybody is with me still? Okay. Sorry, one moment. Let's talk a bit about networking and Syslog-ng. Syslog-ng, as I mentioned, Syslog-ng supports both the legacy or BSD or RFC 3164 Syslog-ng protocol version and the new one. In my talk, I will only talk about the legacy Syslog protocol, as practically everyone is still using it. If one of my colleagues do integration at somewhere, then they use the new one, but I don't think that more than 1% of installations utilize the new Syslog protocol, so I stick to the old one here. And we will also talk about clients, relay, and how Syslog-ng works, the client, the relay, and the server. So how the legacy Syslog message looks like. It starts, it has three major parts: the priority, some headers, and the message. If you take a look at the log files in your varlog directory, then you only see the second and the third one. The priority itself is encoding in into a number two things: the facility, what kind of where the message is originating from. It's there is a nice table, I don't have it here, describing that then what the different numbers are: male, cron, authorization, and whatever. So and there is also severity, which means that the importance of the message, if it's a debug level, if it's regular or warning or emergency. There are 7 different levels. I don't know them by heart. The headers are timestamp, hostname, process name, process ID. The later two are not mandatory, but are of course good to have. And finally, the message part itself, which can be just about anything. So modes of operation. When it comes to networking, Syslog-ng can work in three different modes. One is client mode. So and here client doesn't mean that it's a desktop machine, but your servers are clients as well if they are sending log messages away. So a client is collecting log messages from a machine and sending them to a remote server, either directly or through a relay. The relay, the server is the central machine collecting log messages and storing them either locally or sending them off to somewhere like Elasticsearch or whatever. And in between can be one or more relays, which don't store the log messages, but collect messages, probably even process them, and then forward them to yet another relay or to your central server. Why relays are important? Obviously, if you have just a local network and nothing more, then you don't need them. But if you have a larger network and you have, for example, network devices logging using UDP, you don't want to lose logs, so you put a relay as close to the to your UDP sources as possible. Collect messages using UDP, but forwarding using TCP connections for more reliability. It's also scalability, as if you do lots of message parsing, especially if you use Python for it, then you also need some processing power for message processing, and you can distribute this processing to your relays and do only the storage and on your central server. And it's also structuring your network, like you can put a relay on each side or to each department. And it's also security, as you want your log messages off from your client machines as soon as possible, as while messages are on clients, they can be still modified. But as soon as they left the client machines, they are out of reach of an attacker. So if your clients cannot reach your central server, they can still send messages to your relays, and you can create message buffering on your relays, where messages can be accumulated as long as your center and server is unreachable. Next, we will use Logger to send a few test messages to a network source. We will use this command line to send a test message to a Logger server. -P is for connecting over TCP. The IP address is for the local, minus n stands for hosting or IP, we will use the local host. Capital P is for the port number, and then there is the actual log message. And here is the configuration we will use, the netsource.conf. The beginning of the configuration is the same as we have seen previously. But there is, at the bottom of the screen, there are three more lines. There is a TCP source listening on port 514. There is a destination file called fromnet, where log messages are stored. And finally, there is a log statement which connects the TCP source and the file destination together. So let's do a bit of practice. Here are the steps we will do. So, syntax track. I forgot to show that last time. So, here we did a syntax check and we have the same problem that the version number at the beginning is too old. Obviously for this simple configuration it's not a problem, but if you use some obscure features which changed along the way, then there might be some compatibility problems, like how trying to think that the default message size was changed sometime, or the number of connections handled by default, and how different memory buffers are calculated. But for here, it's not a problem. So let's start. So we started in let source here, and on the right hand side you can see the command line for sending a message, test message over the network. We sent it. And you can see the results, that this is a network test on the last line. Everyone is still with me? Okay. Then let's go on to a bit more interesting features of Syslog-ng. This is where you will work most of your time when it comes to configuring Syslog-ng. For your log messages, it's filtering. Many applications send tremendous amount of data, but if you have a scene system or any other log analysis application, these are mostly licensed. If they are commercial, they are mostly licensed on log volume, so you want to reduce the amount of log messages as much as possible, but not more. It's also because you have a limited amount of storage, so it's not just licensing, it's also storage. And filtering is where you can drop log messages and make sure that, and also to make sure that any important messages reach the right destinations. There are many different filtering functions, and you can connect them using Boolean operators. And we will also see that it's a bit more advanced and not so straightforward at first, but if and else can actually make filtering a lot more easy. These are embedded into the log statement. So at first, they look like a bit of exception to the rules of the pipeline, but they can really, really simplify what was previously possible using multiple log statements and long configuration, and if statement can shorten it quite a bit. So what are macros? These are they are variables created defined by Syslog-ng, either by parsing log messages. So any messages arriving are parsed by default as Syslog message. So as you can see at the bottom of the screen, there are facility, priority, date, and so on are all macros or name value pairs created by Syslog-ng. Actually, date-related macros have different versions, as you can parse dates from log messages, which can be different from the date when the log message actually arrived. So it depends on your intent, which value you use in your templates later on. Templates can be used to create new message formats, or you can also use templates in file names. Here is a very simple template. You define here a template. I don't recall anymore which log analysis application required to have isodate, which also has fractions of a second, not just round seconds, but fractions of a second included. So it's almost the same as a regular syslog in var log messages, but slightly different date format. You can also use templates in file names. So this you can, for example, if you collect, if you have a central syslog.ng server, then you can make sure that messages coming from different hosts are stored into different directories. So here there is a host macro in the file name, so each host stores into a different directory. Or in the second case, the host macro is part of the file name. You can also use this for log rotation, like, and here is what I mentioned, that you can use different date macros. The R in the name of the date macro means that it's the time when it was received. So received year, received month, host name, received day. This way you can store log messages based on the date and have a cron job which deletes when the log messages are no more necessary. Like if you have a compliance requirement to keep for 3 years, then you can have a cron job which compresses log messages the next day and delete them a year or 3 years later. The create dir here means that if the directory where you would store the log message doesn't exist, then it's automatically created. If you don't have this, and you don't have the directory created, then those log messages are lost. I know one use case where it was used. If you have a host-based logging, then you can make sure that for every host you want to log, you create a directory, and even if one of your colleague points a high volume log server to your Syslog-ng server, those messages are dropped as there is no place to store it. But I don't know any other use case for this. Filters, they are declaring filters is pretty much similar to what we have seen previously for sources destinations. The filter keyword, then we have a name for it and some kind of filter function declare. So here we have an example. Filter field as default. Oh, I didn't mention, and it's not mandatory, but many people use this naming convention when they name a source, destination, whatever, that they use the first name of the feature. Like here, for filter, it's F, for a source, it's S, destination D, whatever, in the naming, so they don't mess up the name if they forget that I have a default source and the default filter, then the names clash. And here you can see two filter functions, one for level and one for facility, and they are connected using Boolean operators. There are many different filtering functions. For traditional syslog messages, it's level or facility. Actually, in the original syslog implementation, this was the only filtering possibility. But you can filter on host name, program name. The match filter is matching a regular expression within the message part or any name value pairs. You can call to a different filter as well. And I guess this configuration should look familiar, as this is the very first example I'm showing you. So we have a source, destination, a filter, and a log statement where we use this filter. So source, filter, and destination. And the order is here important, as you can have multiple filters, and you can also have parsers here, and they are executed in the order where how they are in the configuration. There is a special filter which is very close to my heart, as this was my idea coming after a security session somewhere else. It's filtering based on white and blacklisting. This filter compares a single field with a long list of values. So you can have a text file, and on each line you can have a value. The original use case was kind of Boolean's scene system. I mean, there are many different IP address and hostname lists on the internet, for spammers, for malware command and control IP addresses, and very and many different lists, and you can match against this list and create an alert if you see, well, this Windows machine is communicating with a malware command and control, then, well, probably I should investigate what's going on. But more people use it for example, to filter based on application names. So they have a filter that which lists application names which are important for them. So anything related to the SAP system is locked to a separate file or have a list of IP addresses for sales, another list of IP addresses for marketing, another list of IP addresses for development, and log these separately. So there are many different uses for the list filter. So let's go to a bit more advanced topic. Is it's if else. It's practically embedding filters in the log path, creating conditional expressions. It makes a lot more easy to use the results of filtering, as you don't have to use a separate log path for two different results of a filter, but you can do it in the same configuration. For example, to use different parsers on different log messages. The beginning of this configuration should look similar. It should look familiar. The magic starts somewhere here, but if you are using Syslog-ng for a while, you will learn that the actual most important part of the configuration is the log path. That's where everything is connected. So we are also reading the log path, and we'll jump to the other parts of the configuration as necessary. So what we see here, that we use the very same S underline sys source as the other log path. So here we can see that you can reuse the different sources as many times as you want. So we use the same source, and then we apply the pseudo filter. Which is this one. We name it sudo, and it matches on the sudo application. And here comes a trick. As you see, we include the Syslog-ng configuration library in our configuration, which also means that we have a couple of parsers enabled by default. One of these is a parser for sudo log messages. So we have the next line here, the if statement, is actually filtering on the username expected from sudo messages. In our case, it's workshop, and the sudo parser creates name value pairs automatically with a naming that all name value pairs start with dot sudo dot, and after that the actual name of the name value pair. So here we have the username who is running sudo, and we are looking especially for workshop here. And here comes another weird stuff. Until now we had building blocks defined separately, but you can also embed those in the log path. If you know that you don't reuse it anywhere else, then you can create it inside your log path as well. So here we have an embedded file destination. So anything matching workshop is stored to sudo filtered. And finally, everything is written to sudo all file destination defined here. you see that the name is sudo.json, and we use a template function for writing messages. The format JSON template function writes everything in JSON format. It's used also, for example, for Elasticsearch. And this is the name of the template function. Template functions are practically function calls where you can have some parameters and it will generate a message based on these parameters. So here we define define use parameters. The scope is for choosing which name value pairs we want to include in this log message, and name value pairs dot name value pairs mean that it's not there is a tradition that any name value pairs generated by Syslog-ng itself, I mean coming from the Syslog-ng configuration library, the name starting with a dot. So that's why we have the dot name value pairs here as a scope, and the name value pairs is for the rest of the name value pairs. And scope RFC 5424 stands for the regular syslog fields. And we have a few formatting instructions here as well. It's newline as JSON is, if you have a continuous stream of JSON, it's quite difficult to read by a human, even if it's easy for machines. So I put here double line feeds, so we have an empty line between two messages, so it's easier to find where the message starts and ends. We will see it's working later on. Yeah. Practice is coming. And, okay, from this one, we will try the first one, the filter.com, and the last one, the iftest2.com. Okay. It's it's the filter.com what we started on the left hand side, and what you can see here that debug level messages are discarded, and anything coming from the mail facility is discarded. So we can see that our regular log message arrived here, and then I have to cheat a bit. Minus P stands for priority, and the format here is facility and severity. Facility.severity. So we have here a mail facility, and then the log message. And if you check our log messages, we do not see here as it is discarded. Okay, and then let's go on to our other example. For that, This is the sudo example we have seen on our previous slide. You can see that it is storing all of the sudo related messages to var log sudo.json, and any log messages coming from sudo which are coming from the workshop user are stored to var log sudo filter. So what I'm doing here is running sudo as root. Doesn't make much sense, and but good enough for a test. As you can see, it's not here, as it's coming. It's from a previous run of the workshop user, but it's here. You can see it's a nice JSON. And also the command I have just run to ls. So, let's cheat a bit. And we see here, we can see here that the sudo message coming from the workshop user is saved here. So this if statement in our log path actually works. Any questions until now? Okay. For example, the journal. You cannot see the dots here as. I don't sudo. I'm not really good at reading JSON. If I remember well, no. But I don't have it installed. So. Check it back later. Okay. So let's go to message parsing. What it is? It's structuring, classifying, normalizing log messages. Syslog-ng has a technology called portability. It forces parsing unstructured log messages, and we have parsers for JSON, XML, CSV, and a few other structured message formats. Why message parsing is important? It allows much more precise filtering and thus alerting, and it also allows saving only relevant data. And it's not just filtering. Last week I was in a conference in Arizona, Phoenix, Arizona, and one of our Syslog-ng users explained the use case that even my jaw drops the floor, that they are they investigated what their scene system is actually using from the log messages they are pushing there, and then what they did, that they figured out that they have probably 20-30 different fields passed from log messages, but the scene is using only 4 of those for any kind of analysis, which meant that they configured Syslog-ng in a way that it's parsing the incoming message. It drops everything except for the 4 fields needed by the scene. It meant for them that 90% of the log message could be thrown away, at least from the scene point of view. They stored it locally for compliance, but to the scene, to the other side of the USA, they only had to forward 1/10 of the original log message, which meant a huge drop in licensing and a huge drop in networking traffic, a huge drop in storage. Of course, it needs quite a bit of investigation, as you need to know, you actually need to know what is used for log analysis, but it's worth the trouble, as as far as I could understand, it meant multiple terabytes per day as savings. So it's quite useful. And of course, it doesn't work everywhere, but and it's an extreme case, but you can save quite a lot with filtering, with parsing and reformatting as well. So let's talk about parsers. One of the oldest parsers within Syslog-ng is the portability parser, which can extract information from unstructured messages into name value pairs. It can also add status fields based on the message text, and do message classification like log check in Debian. But there is a drawback of portability, as it needs an XML database describing your log messages. So it cannot just look at it, take a wild guess what it is, and say something, but you actually need a database describing your log messages. On the other hand, when you have this database, and we have a few examples on GitHub how to create one, it can come quite handy. Coming back to my favorite SSH login message example, the parsed values from the log message are the application name, the username, the source IP. As we have the log message in the XML database, we can create some additional name value pairs based on the on the log message, that it's a login message, and it's a login failure, actually, and we can classify it at the end as a violation. Uh, JSON parser. Anything in the message part of a log message is treated as plain text or string or whatever. So it's not parsed from it's from the Syslog-ng point of view, it's a black box. You need to use a parser on the log message in order to have name value parse created. So if you look at the JSON message and you see that it includes name value parse, as long as you don't apply a name parser to it within Syslog-ng, it's just plain text from the Syslog-ng point of view. And once you parse it, you can use the resulting name value pairs for filtering or self-key storage or whatever you want. It works in some cases. Personally, I don't have configuration here, and I don't know how to do it. I know that I've seen it working. It's a bit longer and more difficult configuration. It should work, but I don't have it here. There is a CSV parser, and it's not just comma separated values, but any kind of columnar data. For example, one of the typical use cases was Apache access log. Here you can see the field names for Apache access log: client, item, name, username, timestamp, and so on. Everything parsed from the log message, and here you can see that in the destination we use in the file name template the username parsed from the log message. So if there is a username then included, then it's stored var log messages username. Or if there is no username included, then it's called messages no user. Another parser which is very popular is the key value parser. As most of the different firewalls store log messages as in a key value format, like this one, these log messages, and there are some further parsers like an XML parser, which can be used. I think the original use case was some logs from a Java application, but I might be wrong. I never used it. You can. There's a parser for Linux audit logs, or also a date parser where you can have. Template. There are many different date formats, and you can have a template which describes the given date format in your log message and parse it. And the parser stores the date to the sender date macros. There are also many different parsers in the Syslog-ng configuration library. I already mentioned sudo. There is a dedicated parser for Apache access logs, which combines the CSV parser and the date parser together. Also, Cisco log messages are quite, well, how to say, interesting, as they look like Cisco messages, but they are not complying to anything related to Syslog. So what we try to do that with some heuristics parse these Syslog looking messages from Cisco and parse those as if they were regular Syslog messages, and also create some additional fields if there is, what is it called, Cisco Nanomics or whatever. Those can also be parsed alternatively. Obviously, not all of the Cisco devices are covered, as practically each and every of them have a different date format. Log format. And I already mentioned that Python is a jolly joker here, as you can parse quite complex data formats using your using Python code, or even use external data sources like SQL or queries or whatever to enrich your log messages. Obviously, writing anything using anything written in Python is slower than C, but it has many advantages, as it doesn't need any compilation, it doesn't need a development environment, and there are a lot more libraries available ready to use than for C. And it's quicker and everything. Some performance values. On a machine which can process about 500,000 messages per second, if, without any encryption or advanced message parsing or whatever, the Python parser can handle about 1/10 of that. To put it into a perspective, most of the Syslog-ng users are collecting messages less than 100 messages per second. So even a Raspberry Pi can handle that amount. I already mentioned application adapters. It's for parsing log messages automatically, like I mentioned Cisco's sudo. There are a few more parsers bundled with Syslog-ng, and every other release has something added for this. It's enabled by default since 3.13. And there is a very nice name, enterprise-wide message model, but in practice what it means that you can forward name value pairs between Syslog-ng instances in JSON formatting. This is good as you can preserve the original log message and the parsed name value pairs, everything. And obviously, as it's message parsing, it has some performance limits, but it works. And this configuration should look already familiar for you. The magic is here in the second line, include scl.conf, Syslog-ng configuration library includes these parsers I mentioned on the previous slide. So that's why in the filtering example we could use the results of a sudo parser even without having the sudo parser here in our configuration. Let's jump to enriching log messages. Sorry, I need this as my thought is. What enriching means? It means that you can create additional name value pairs based on the message content. I already mentioned pattern DB for this. But we have two more technologies, GIP parser and edge contextual data. We will see what these are. Can you recall pattern DB? There I mentioned that you can create additional status fields based on the message, like if we store SSH login failure into our external database, then we can put it next to it that it's a login related message and also that it's a failure. So pattern DB is one of the possibilities for enriching log messages. GIP is another one, which GIP can help you to find the geolocation of an IP address. It's using external databases for that. Note that the component of Syslog-ng is still called GIP, but actually the library which is called GIP is phased out. The database is no more maintained, as far as is even probably removed from the web. And it's called now MaxMindDB, which contains a lot more information than just geolocation. I mean, longitude, latitude. It also contains city name if it's there, or country name, continent name, whatever. So way a lot more information. What you can use it for example, detect anomalies. If one of your users logs in from Brussels and 5 minutes later from St. Petersburg, from Russia, then probably you have a problem. But it also can be used for some eye candy, like Silver guys love maps. So even if it has no practical use at all, you can show that you have attacks coming from China, from Russia, from the US, from Brazil. I remember one of the malware outbreaks coming from there, and I had it was looking fantastic on my map. The other possibility is adding metadata from CSV files, for example, a host role or a contact person, which is useful as you can create a lot more accurate alerts and dashboards using this information. So you see that a log message is coming from marketing or from developers. And you can alert the responsible sysadmin based on this information, or there are many other possibilities. Next, we will use Log-ng. That's the benchmarking and message sending tool bundled with Syslog-ng. It can generate log messages or post the content of an existing log file. Here is a nice example. This is the one we will use. I prepared some sample data for you, and we will post it to first to a file, and it doesn't look completely hopeless to post it to Elasticsearch at the end. So here are the options we will use. Minus I stands for internet. Minus capital S for TCP connections. We use minus D, don't pairs. I removed the message headers from the log messages and used the don't pairs option, as otherwise the dates would be fixed to something ancient and it would be quite difficult to find these messages in Elasticsearch. So instead of that, I used don't pairs and use the current date. And finally, where the logs are coming from and where we want to send it. And here are the example logs I used. It's coming from IP tables. And for the logs we send, I removed the header part. And here is the configuration we will use. As usual, we start looking at the log statement. We see that there is a TCP source. Here it is, listening on port 514. Then we have a key value parser that's up here. As if you take a look, you see that IP tables logs are key, in a key value format. And for any value parsed from the IP tables logs, we use a KV prefix. So we don't interfere with the rest of the name value pairs. Then the next one is a GIP parser. You see here source IP. So we parse it with the key value parser and we use the KV prefix, so it's stored in kv.src. For GIP we use this field, this database, and prefix the result with GIP2. And finally we store the results into a file. And here we use the JSON parser again. The JSON template function again. The difference here is that we use a feature called rekey on anything starting with a dot and remove the dot. We do this because when we Elasticsearch doesn't like name value pairs starting with a dot, so what we do is replace it with an underline. On the other hand, this has a special meaning within Elasticsearch, so I don't remember, it's not indexed, cannot be searched, and similar troubles. So what we do here is remove the leading dot, so anything we store here can be later stored to Elasticsearch. And we also do some magic here and create a timestamp as required by Elasticsearch. So we will use the almost the very same template in Elasticsearch. The only difference will be that the two line things at the end will be removed. But it's almost the same configuration as we will use for Elasticsearch. But here we still store to a file. Here, I guess we better skip the first two configurations and jump directly to the last one. But first, okay, and then and here is the command line for what I've shown you previously. It's log-ng, so the tool bundled with Syslog-ng, and it sends the unparsed log messages to Syslog-ng to port 514. That was all. And now, if we take a look at var log from net, as you can see here, then we will see that here is a nice long JSON-based log message. First, here we have the name value pairs from the key value parser. So we have KV and then of the name value pairs parsed from the IP tables message. And here we have the GIP part up until here. So here you can see United States, the time zone, even the time zone. ISO code for the country and the actual geolocation, and then the regular Syslog related fields and the even the original message. Yes. Oops, I ran out of time. Oh, I didn't hold the sorry. No. The only thing is missing here is the actual Elasticsearch stuff. But then let's go there quickly. I knew that I will run out. Originally, we implemented Elasticsearch in Java, but it has the problem that it cannot be included in distributions. So there is no an HTTP destination in Syslog-ng based on curl, and we use that for Elasticsearch. There is an Elasticsearch HTTP destination. The Java-based destination is still better if you have an extreme load. Otherwise, the HTTP destination is much better. From any possible, and here is how you configure it. Index name, type, URL, and you recall the template from the previous example. It's almost exactly the same except for the new lines at the end. For GIP, here is an extra thing we do. Elasticsearch doesn't like if we have a part of, if part of the GIT information is missing, so we make sure that we write GIT information only if we have it. To get GIT working on the Elasticsearch part, we need mapping. And okay, let's try it. If it doesn't work in 1 minute, 2 minutes, then okay. We sent it there, and I don't even have you see the logs I sent here, and right, it, here are all the GIT informations, and with a minimal lag, or not even here, just oops, oh, I don't have internet connection, as I didn't want to have any kind of pop-ups during my talk, but you should see a world map in the background, and here are the points from the IP, and that was all.